Bismillahi was salatu was salamu ala rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amma ba'd. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you and to introduce you to a brand new show and a brand new podcast called The Hot Seat. To understand a little bit more about The Hot Seat, we first have to understand the context of the modern day world we find ourselves living in the year 2019. It is a world in which perhaps there are more doubts, misconceptions, and misinterpretations that are thrown around about the religion of Islam than in any other period of time in the history of mankind. The internet is a number one source used by people globally to acquire information on any topic, and it is riddled and full of false notions and erroneous ideologies about the deen of Allah, Azza wa Jal. Our kids, ourselves, are being exposed to this kind of information on a daily, and if not daily, then at the very least weekly basis. And whether we know it or not, whether we choose to accept it or not, it is having an effect on ourselves, our hearts, our minds, and ultimately our understanding of this beautiful religion. To further complicate the problem, many of us find ourselves living in Western societies where the governments and the social norms and pressures are constantly trying to redefine what is good and what is bad, what is accepted and what is rejected, what Islam is and is allowed to be, and what Islam is never allowed to be. All of this, my brothers and sisters, ultimately leads to confusion, it leads to ignorance, and if Allah permits, it can lead to misguidance. The Hot Seat has therefore been designed with the permission of Allah alone to counter these kind of modern day, contemporary issues head on by using the knowledge and the guidance of the Muslims of the past, the early generations of Muslims, the best of generations. There's not a single Muslim on the face of the planet today that would doubt the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completed our religion for us over 1400 years ago. And that completed, holistic, perfect religion is just as applicable now in the year 2019 as it was back then. We truly do have classical solutions for contemporary problems. However, this isn't your normal average Islamic lecture series. First of all, it's not a lecture. It's a discussion between two parties, often opposing parties, in an attempt to reach the truth, bi'idhnillah. And secondly, and perhaps more importantly, it's a unique, one-of-its-kind interactive podcast where you, from the comfort of your own home, have the opportunity to vote for and to choose the topic we'll be discussing on the show. You also have the chance to ask your own questions on these contemporary issues and to grill the speaker if you feel like he hasn't been grilled enough on the show itself. I'll be releasing details of how you can do both of those things at the end of this episode. But for now, without any further ado, let's get into this episode of The Hot Seat. وَإِن تَعْجَبْ فَعَجَبٌ قَوْلُهُمْ أَإِذَا كُنَّا تُرَابًا أَإِنَّا لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ أولئك الذين كفروا بربهم وأولئك الأغلال في أعناقهم وأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just before we get into this episode, I just want to mention, stick around until the end of this episode because we have a very special and exciting announcement for you guys. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ustaz Abdul Rahman Hassan, how are you today?
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, barakallah fiqh.
We have a very, very important topic to discuss today, and that is the issue of the Sunnah and Hadiths, and whether they are actually part of the religion or not. And if they are part of the religion, then can we actually trust them? Have they been preserved or not? So I want to start the discussion with a really, really simple question. And that is, why do you feel like the words of Allah in the Qur'an is not enough for you? Why do you have to turn to the words of a human being?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Lahu Alhamdul Hassan, Wa Thana'u Al-Jameel. Wa Ashhadu an La Ilaha Illallah Wahdahu La Sharika Lah, Yaqulu Al-Haqqa Wa Huwa Yahdi Al-Sabeel. Wa Ashhadu Anna Sayyidina Wa Nabiyyina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. The answer to your question is, Allah Azza wa Jalla is the one who commanded us to go to legislations from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's Allah who commanded us. Allah says in the Quran, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah tells us subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to teach two things. He came to teach the Qur'an and he came to teach wisdom. Now the Qur'an, we all know what it is. It's the book of Allah azza wa jalla. And what else was Allah referring to when he said that he came to teach us hikmah, wisdom?
Does the Qur'an have wisdom in it?
لا شك ولا ريب. There's no doubt about
that.
Feel,
why are you then saying that this has to be something other than the Qur'an?
First of all, the ayah says, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعْثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And you know the Arabic language, and we've studied in the Arabic language, that the waw that's used in its default position, the asal, the original usage of the waw in the Arabic language, is that it shows that these two things are two separate things.
And you also know that there are many times in the Qur'an where there is a waw that comes, but it's not referring to two separate things. For example, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Is seeking help from Allah not also worship, yet there is a waw in between them?
So, that's why I said the default position is that the waw فِي أَصْلِ اللُّغَةِ تَقْتَضِي الْمُغَايَرَةِ. The waw in the Arabic language, it shows that two things are separate. Like the ayah, what did it say? That I mentioned, that he teaches the Qur'an and he teaches wal-hikmah, wisdom, wal-hikmah, the waw is there. So those are two different entities. You're now saying, but there is verses in the Qur'an here and there where Allah uses the waw, but they show the same thing.
Yes.
Like, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ.
Correct.
Allah mentioned, مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَالَ.
Yeah.
We'll say that this is an exception. It's an exception from that example, because this is called atful khasi ala al-am. It's called atful khasi ala al-am. You're taking a specific and you're attributing it to a general. That happens in the Quran, but it's not in this situation.
Just because it doesn't suit you, why can't we use it in this situation? For example, the kitab mentioned in this verse, the one that you're talking about, is the Quran in general, and the hikmah is the wisdom found in the Quran. Very similar thing. It's actually taking something specific from the same thing that is general.
Allah said in another ayah, وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah is saying to the wives of the Prophet, Allah is saying to them, وَذْكُرْنَ mention, وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ, mention what was read in your houses, what was recited in your houses. And Allah mentioned two things that were recited in their houses. The verses of Allah and wisdom. We know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not always talking Quran. You and I
correct.
Both know.
I agree with that. Yeah.
That's the wisdom. Every day, every minute, every second wasn't talking Quran. He wasn't reading Quran sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was speech other than that which he was saying. That's what the wisdom is referring to here. That is what it's saying.
The reason why I have an issue with this is because in another ayah in the Quran, Allah says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We revealed the Quran upon you as a clarification for all things. So I return to the question. Allah, your creator, is telling you that the book contains everything you need to know. Kulli shay'in. Why then do you feel like it doesn't contain everything you need?
You see, you're right. The Quran clarifies everything to us. It does. It tells us everything that we need to know. And if it wants us to know more information regarding a matter, the Quran has clarified for us who we need to go to, which is the messenger. Allah says in another ayah, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Muhammad, we sent the Quran on you to clarify for the people. So Allah clarified everything for us. He did in the Quran, because he told us what we needed in the verses that we needed, and the meaning that is in those verses, Allah told us it. And whichever other verses that we don't understand its meaning, like وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayer, وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةِ, give zakat, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حُجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. These verses, we don't know how to implement it. So the messenger came and he told us how we need to come and how we need to implement these verses and what these verses mean. So you're right when you say that the Quran clarified everything for us. It did. It clarified for us everything by telling us what each verse means, and it also clarified it for us by telling us to go to the messenger when there is a verse that's ambiguous. So the Quran, yes, it did clarify everything to us.
Okay, let's move on.
But that's not the only verse where Allah tells us to go to the messenger. Allah says, مَن يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Anyone who obeys the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has obeyed Allah azza wa jalla. So If one wants to obey Allah Azza wa Jalla, he has to obey the messenger. And if he doesn't obey the messenger, that person hasn't obeyed Allah Azza wa Jalla.
I would still argue that because the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam brought the Qur'an to us, even when you obey him in terms of what he's bringing from the Qur'an, one could say that obeying Allah and obeying his messenger is restricted to the Qur'an only. Mm. One could say that. But I really want to talk about a more specific
evidence. That question, okay, من يطيع الرسول, anyone who obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah. Anyone who restricts an unrestricted verse has to bring evidence for that. Because the ayah says, من يطيع الرسول, anyone who obeys the messenger. This obedience is in his speech, it's in his action, it's what he got from the Qur'an, and he also, and also anything he got from other than the Qur'an. It's unrestricted. So if you say it's only referring to taking from the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he took it from the Qur'an, I would say this requires evidence.
Fair point. I'll bring my evidence right now. تِلْكَ آيَاتُ اللَّهِ نَتْلُوهَا عَلَيْكَ بِالْحَقِّ فَبِأَيِّ حَدِيثٍ بَعْدَ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah says, these are the verses of Allah, we recite them upon you with truth. Then in which hadith, the word actually in Arabic used is actually hadith in this verse. Then in which hadith after Allah and his verses will they believe? Isn't this clearly telling us not to follow the hadith and stick to the Quran?
So the hadith that it was referring to, the ayah came down on, and the scholars, they mention, وَالسِّيَاقُ مِنَ الْمُقَيِّدَاتِ, the context explains it, is that people were taking the speeches of others other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. They were taking speeches from other than Allah Azza wa Jalla,
like the messenger,
and from other than the messenger. Because we brought evidence to say that the messenger is an exception here. Anyone who takes a speech other than Allah's speech subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this person is what the ayah is referring to. Because if you say hadith here, it means hadith as what we know,
yes,
it today,
we know it, yeah.
That wasn't coined at that time. The word hadith was never called hadith at the time of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
So it's an innovation.
The definition, or the meaning, or the reality.
The reality and the word itself.
No, the reality. No, it's not. It's not an innovation, but the definition were coined after. The reason why it was coined after is because the Arabs at that time didn't need to know what a hadith was. The Sahabas didn't need to be told, you know, this is what hadith means and this is not what a hadith means. They were saliqi. This was innate for them. You know, like they didn't need to know Arabic grammar, like they didn't need to know usulul fiqh. These people, they didn't need definitions. Definitions came after, when the non-Arabs started to take Islam and embrace Islam, and doubt started to creep into them, and ignorance started to increase. This is when terms became defined. But the definition and the reality of the definition was always at the time of the messenger. So my question here is, my point here, sorry, is that the word hadith here is, it's not referring to the messenger. And it's something we need to take on board, which is we need to take the whole entire Qur'an together. We need to take the Qur'an together. This is not referring to the messenger. It was referring to the Quraysh and the disbelievers who took the speeches of their forefathers over the speech of Allah and his messenger. But we have extensive verses, many multitude verses, which instruct us, rather command us, that we need to follow the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Anything which the Messenger gives to you, take from him. And whatever he prohibits from you, stay away from.
And the context of that verse was?
The context in which it came down was the Messenger, the battle that he had with the people of Banu Nadir, where Allah says, وَمَا أَفَاءَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ مِنْهُمْ فَمَا أَوْجَفْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ خَيْرٍ وَلَا رِكَابٍ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يُسَلِّطُ رُسُلَهُ عَلَىٰ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ مَا أَفَاءَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ من أهل القرى فلله وللرسول ولذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل كي لا يكون دولة بين الأغنياء منكم وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا واتقوا الله. This ayah mentions here, وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه. Whatever the messenger gave to you, take it from him.
Just gives a summary of the context of what
the context was. Of course, it was talking about spoils of war.
Spoils of war.
It was talking about booty, but the spoils of war and the booty, it's not only restricted to that. No one from the Sahabas, the noble companions, understood it to be that.
Do you not think by the wording, that Allah saying whatever he gives you is quite clearly talking about the act of giving, like you would give spoils of war? Allah didn't say whatever he does, you do. He said whatever he gives you. Don't you think that's quite clearly and quite obviously talking about the spoils of war here?
But how did he give them the spoils of war? Based on a legislation from Allah Azza wa Jalla, right? From the Sunnah, right?
He gave it through his own actions. Yeah, it wasn't detailed in the Qur'an who to give. He gave it through his own actions, no doubt.
So what he gave them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is unrestricted. Sunnah can be given. Like, I gave these persons a couple of hadiths, I could say that wouldn't be wrong. Let me flip the question to you.
Okay.
If I say, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ, can that ayah be used as taking the Qur'an?
Yes.
I could use that for the Qur'an.
Yeah, it could.
But it's not talking about the Qur'an, it's talking about spoils of war.
Yeah, correct.
I'm trying to show you that you can't use this verse now because the ayah is only talking about spoils of war.
He's talking about the Qur'an, and in this particular circumstance, talking about the spoils of war. But to take a specific example where Allah says, take this, and then to say, therefore we can take everything, is a stretch.
I'm saying the best people, who are the most eloquent of people, the companions, that's what they understood it as.
Okay, let's move on to the Sunnah itself. Didn't the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbid the companions from writing down his statements and only stick to writing down the Qur'an? Why?
It is true that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the companions, لَا تَكْتُبُوا عَنِّي غَيْرَ الْقُرْآنِ وَمَنْ كَتَبَ عَنِّي غَيْرَ الْقُرْآنِ فَلْيَمْحُوا. That don't write from me other than the Qur'an, and anyone who wrote other than the Qur'an from me, then wipe it. That was something that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. But there was also situations where the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to a noble companion who wanted a narration to be written for him, or something that the Messenger said, and then he asked for it, and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to the companions, "Uktubu li Abi Shah," write for Abu Shah. You see, so there were times that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his narrations were written in his presence. You know the famous hadith of Abu Hurairah. He said, "Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he wrote more than I did in hadiths." This also proves that the hadiths were written. Not to mention the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, the noble companion, Quraysh went to him and they said to him, "Are you writing everything the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says?" I mean, he's a human. He laughs, he jokes, he'll say things out of anger sometimes, he'll say out of joy. Do you write everything he says? And so this made Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, shocked. So he went to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, this is what they said to me." And the Messenger said to him, "Uktub, فَوَلَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٌ بِيَدِي." Right, I swear by the Lord in which Muhammad's soul is in his hand. لا يخرج من هذه إلا الحق. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said, "Right, for verily nothing other than the truth comes out of my mouth." So this is a clear statement of his. Not to mention Allah said in the Quran, Allah said in the ayah in the Quran, "يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا تَدَايَنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمًّا فَاكْتُبُوهُ وَلْيَكْتُبْ بَيْنَكُمْ كَاتِبٌ بِالْعَدْلِ." Allah says in that ayah, those of you who believe, if you're going to take money or loan and borrow money from one another, Allah says, write it. And the ones who write it, who testify to it, the witness, everything, مِمَّنْ تَرْضَوْنَ مِنَ الشُّهَدَاءِ. The witness are going to be reliable people. I'm asking you a sincere question. If we were told to write debt, why wouldn't we write the Prophet's life? Why wouldn't we write his statements and his words? Why wouldn't we write his interpretation of verses and what he said about them?
The answer to that question is because hundreds of years later, we would end up in a situation where Muslims would actually equate that with the Qur'an and believe that the legislative rulings coming from the Messenger, who was a human being, are equal to the legislative rulings coming from Allah, who is our creator and his creator. And that is exactly the situation we find ourselves today, is it not?
I mean, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the reasons he did say, "Don't write whatever comes from me," at the beginning of Islam, and was abrogated at the end, it's actually abrogated, was that the fear that people may not distinguish the Quran from the Sunnah.
Exactly.
One from the other. That they don't, because people are going to read. You see, the difference between the Quran and the Sunnah is that the Quran's wordings are mutaabadun bitilawati. You are worshipping Allah on every letter of the Quran, not the Sunnah. So if the people don't distinguish one from the other, they would be saying, for example, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin, innama al-amalu bin-niyat, in the Salah.
Okay, right.
Not being able to distinguish one from the other. So he didn't want that to happen. He wanted people to know this is the Quran and this is what you pray Salah with.
So other than that, there's no difference. In terms of legislation, in terms of judgment and ruling, you believe that the Sunnah is equal to the Quran?
In judgment and ruling, yes it is.
Then why does Allah say, أَفَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْتَغِي حَكَمًا وَهُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكِتَابَ مُفَصَّلًا. Allah says, is it anybody other than Allah I should take hakama as a judge, when he is the one who has revealed the Qur'an upon you completely detailed, mufassal, detailed.
Sahih. Again, another thing we need to go back to is you can't just take one verse and abandon the other verses. So you have to take all of those verses together. Again, what did we say at the beginning? مَنْ يُطْعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. So in essence, if you take Allah as a hakam, you've taken the messenger as a hakam by default. You've taken it by, because that's all, the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is explaining what the Qur'an has mentioned. He's even adding legislations from that which is in the Qur'an, like in from Allah azza wa jalla. So it's Allah who judged.
So for example, the legislation of growing your beard is not found in the Qur'an, but it's found in the Sunnah.
Which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took from Allah azza wa jalla.
Why, if it's so important?
I mean,
important,
you know the famous Roman leader who came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I mean the messenger that they sent to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the man, he had shaved his beard and he had a big moustache. And so he said to him, who commanded you this? Man amaraka bihada? Who commanded you to shave your beard and to let your moustache thick? And then he said to him, my lord, referring to his leader. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grabbed his own beard and he said, Allahu amarani bihada. And Allah commanded me this.
Pause, question here. If it's important for us to know that, why didn't Allah mention it first in the Quran?
وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Allah already told us, Muhammad, we sent the Quran on you, so you can clarify for the people. You see, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is here. That's his job. That's his role, alayhi salatu wasalam, is to explain things to you, for you to see how to live your life, how to be a Muslim, what to do and what not to do. That's his job, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's why when we dispute one another and we argue with one another, we take it back to him. فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If you dispute one another and you argue, bring it back to Allah and His Messenger. I ask a question. We know what it means to bring it back to Allah.
Mm-hmm.
And we know what it means to bring it back to the Messenger when he was alive. But how do I bring it back to the Messenger now? How? Because we can't say that verse is not implemented. Of course it's implemented. The Quran was sent down for it to be implemented. So this verse says, take it back to the Messenger. He's not with us right now. How do I take it back to him?
Okay. Out of sincerity, I would have to say that you brought a lot of evidences from the Quran.
You haven't answered my question.
It's a difficult one to answer. But I also want to go on to another point, which is if you say that Allah is commanding us to take the Sunnah of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how do we know it's been preserved correctly? How do we know it's reached us correctly to this day?
So that answer of your question would have allowed me to move on to that point, which is if you had said that after the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam's death, we have to take it back to his Sunnah. Because he's not with us anymore. It's his Sunnah that we're taking it back to. Allah only would say that if the Sunnah is preserved.
But do we not have weak hadith? Do we not have fabricated hadith? Do we not have hadith that the scholars disagree on?
Without a doubt, there is.
Sure.
There are weak narrations. There are fabricated narrations. There are liars who try to lie about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But that doesn't dismiss there are authentic hadiths. And you and I know that it wasn't the Qur'aniyun, the supposed Qur'aniyun, who came out and proved that these hadith were weak. No, it's the people who mentioned the Qur'an, the ones who mentioned the Sunnah as a source of evidence, they were the ones who showed these hadith are weak. It is them who stood up to prove that these are authentic and these are weak. As the poet said, فَسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةِ بِصِحَّةِ الْمَرْوِيِّ عَنْ الرَّسُولِ لِيُعْلَمَ الْمَرْدُودُ مِنْ مَقْبُولِ لَا سِيَّمَا عِنْدَ تَظَاهُرِ الْفِتَنِ وَلَبْسِ إِفْكِ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ بِالسُّنَنِ فَقَامَ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ الْأَئِمَّةُ بِخِدْمَةِ الدِّينِ وَنُصْحِ الْأُمَّةِ فَمَيَّزُوا أَمَّا فَخَلَّصُوا صَحِيحَهَا مِنْ مُفْتَرَى حَتَّى صَفَتْ نَقِيَّةً كَمَا تَرَى. It was the scholars who stood up and they distinguished the weak narrations from the authentic narrations. It was Abdullah ibn Mubarak. It was Ibn Juraij. It was Imam al-Bukhari. It was Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Ali ibn Medini. Not the so-called Qur'aniyun.
These scholars are men, are they not? They're human beings,
they're
correct?
Human beings, yeah.
It's not from our belief and our creed as Muslims that human beings can make mistakes.
Yeah, so without doubt.
So just so I understand your position, you're saying we're entrusting our source of legislation in the religion to human beings.
I gave you an example at the beginning of the verse that when you're taking debt from somebody, a witness, Allah Azza wa Jalla said in that verse, فَاسْتَشْهِدُوا شَهِيدَيْنِ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ. Test it. One or two men as witnesses, Allah said it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm taking men for a witness on a worldly issue.
Correct.
You know,
because a worldly issue is much smaller than a religious issue.
Yeah?
A worldly issue is not as important as a religious issue.
Without a doubt, but it's if we look, the thing is here is, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. Another qira'ah says, فَتَثَبَّتُوا. If a fasiq comes to you, إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ, if a fasiq comes to you with news, فَتَثَبَّتُوا, verify it. That's what the ayah says. That's the بِمَنْطُوقِ الْآيَةِ. The ayah directly says to us, if a fasiq comes to you with a news, then verify it. What about if the person is not a fasiq?
Then according to that ayah, then it's okay.
Yeah, we don't need to verify, right?
Yeah.
So the ayah told me that if I see a reliable person who meets the conditions of integrity, he's reliable, I don't need to verify. I take his word.
So these conditions of integrity and reliable and, for example, strong memory, etc., I'm assuming we got it from Allah and His Messenger.
They're scattered all over the verses of the Qur'an, here or there, na'am. But that ayah is the backbone to use, that the people who are reliable, because they say we take the Qur'an, sah?
Yes.
They're not taking the Qur'an, to be honest, because I mentioned many ayats that show that we need to take the sunnah. But let's, for the sake of argument, let's say they take the Qur'an. Well, here it is. Allah saying, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَمَا فَتَثَبَّتُوا. And here we have a person who you wouldn't say is fasiq.
Do you really think someone like Al Bukhari, who came 250 years after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, is reliable? I mean, considering that there's such a long time span between him and the Messenger, surely that something could have gone wrong in that entire chain, whether intentionally or unintentionally, and mistakes happen.
I mean, if you're alluding to that Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, was the first person to write the hadith of the Prophet, and then that's...
Was he not?
No, of course he wasn't.
Who preceded him then?
Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, wasn't even the sixth or seventh person who wrote hadith. There were many, many scholars before him that wrote hadith. First of all, we have to understand, the same way that the Qur'an was written and the same people who we trusted with the Qur'an are the same people we're trusting with the sunnah here right now.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, look at the sunnah right now. Look at the sunnah. The sunnah was memorized and it was written. The Qur'an was memorized and it was written. Remember, first of all, you need to know the hifdh of the Qur'an. How was the Qur'an protected? First, it was memorized, right?
Yes.
Allah told us in the ayah, بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ في صدور الذين أوتوا العلم وإنه لتنزيل رب العالمين نزل به الروح الأمين على قلبك لتكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين. That the Quran was memorized in the Prophet's chest, and then it moved on to the chest and the hearts of the companions. بل هو آيات بينات في صدور الذين أوتوا العلم. It was compiled in the hearts of the believers. They memorized it. They kept it in their chest. And then after that, Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه came, and he brought that whole entire Qur'an that were written. It was written. It just wasn't compiled. The Qur'an was written before Abu Bakr, but he brought it together. He did jama'ah. And I need to give you the long, it will take us probably a bit, but the lines of poetry that Imam Abu Hakash, Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi in his kitab, Aqilatu Atrab al-Qasaid, he mentions that the story of how it took place. He says, ولم يزل حفظه بين الصحابة في علا حياة رسول الله مبتدرا وكل عام على جبريل يعرضه وقيل آخر عام عرضتين قرا إن اليمامة أهواها مسيلمة الكذاب في زمن الصديق إذ خسر وبعد بأس شديد حان مصرعه وكان بأسا على القراء مستعرا نادى أبا بكر للفاروق خفت على القراء فادرك القرآن مستطرا فأجمعوا جمعه في الصحف واعتمدوا زيد بن ثابت العدل الرضا نظرا فقام فيه بعون الله يجمعه بالنصح والجد والحزم الذي بهرا من كل أوجه حتى استتم له بالأحرف السبعة العليا كما اشتهر. أبو بكر رضي الله تعالى عنه compiled the Quran.
Okay.
He felt that the people who were memorizing the Quran had died or were dying, and so he felt the need to compile the Quran. Okay, but the Quran was written before. The same with the Sunnah. The Sunnah was memorized and it was what?
Sorry, the Sunnah was memorized and compiled in its entirety at the time of Abu Bakr?
No, not Abu
Bakr.
Okay,
so there's a difference.
But I'm talking about both of them at the time of the Messenger.
Both of them at the time of the Messenger, the Quran was written down in its entirety, not necessarily compiled, but it was written down.
All of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ were either written or memorized.
Okay,
just like but same with the Quran, either memorized or written.
But more of the Quran was written than the Sunnah. Would you agree on that at the very least?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean,
and then the Quran also was compiled in its entirety way before the Sunnah was.
Again, the reason was because the people who were memorizing the Qur'an were feared to die.
Yes.
Whereas not the Sunnah.
No doubt. I don't mind about the reason. What my, the point I'm trying to make is if you're trying to say that the process was the same for the two, so you accept this one, why don't you accept this one? I don't think that's fair. I think the process in itself, from a bird's eye view, was similar, but the details distinguish that this one was compiled much
earlier. So let's take a step back. At the time of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Qur'an was memorized and it was written. The Sunnah was memorized and it was written. We agree on that?
Not necessarily. That's a general statement. When we look at the specifics, we just agreed that more of the Qur'an was written than memorized in comparison to the Sunnah. Do you agree on that? Because you can say a general statement, but...
It doesn't change my argument. The fact that something with more or less doesn't really...
It completely changes it because there's more chance of this one being lost if it was written less, whereas this one was written much more. There's less chance of it being lost. And that's exactly what we're talking about.
That would mean that the Sunnah was written, an amount of the Sunnah was written that could be lost.
So what do you mean by that?
For example, when you said that the Qur'an, a lot of it was written.
Yes.
And I said to you, a lot of the Sunnah was written as well. Meaning all of the Sunnah was written.
Yes.
And it was also memorized.
If you said that, yeah.
And all of it was memorized.
If you said that, I'd trust it much more.
The entire Sunnah was either written or memorized.
Okay, but that's different. Memorization is different to writing. Do you agree?
For the Arabs, it was really the same. They were a people who passed everything on by memory. So it's funny, I met a man who was an Arabic teacher. He taught Arabic. He was an Arabic teacher. And I said to him, you teach Arabic? And he's a Qur'an. He calls himself Qur'ani. He's followed the Qur'an. So I said, how do you teach Arabic? And he goes, yeah, I teach it. Imr Uqais, Antal ibn Shaddad, Zuhair ibn Abi Sulma. These are the books, the Arabic poetry. So I said, you believe it's preserved? He says, yeah, but you don't believe the Sunnah is preserved. The pre-Islamic poetry, we have it today, it's written. We read it for you. This is 100, Imr Uqais was 150 years before the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The reason why the Quran wasn't sent down in one book, or even the small portions that came down, it wasn't done on papers, because Allah knew these people were people of hifdh. Their memory was unique. And it's not fair that you compare something that was done at that time for its context and you want to compare it to yourself right now. It's incorrect. You're looking at it wrong. If you want to know their reasons behind things, you need to look at how they were as people. These people would listen to a poetry once from a man, all of it at once. He would hear it and he'd memorize it. And that's how they passed it on. ولذلك الإمام الشاطبي said, كان العلم من قبل في صدور الرجال. Knowledge before was in the men's hearts. You think Imam Muhammad used to come to a halaqa and he would sit down and he would read from a paper and a book? These people knew thousands and thousands of narrations from the top of their heads. And they wouldn't get it wrong. Their hifd was thaqib. Had solid memory. That's one. That's a form of preservation. You can't deny, especially if you know the Arab tradition. Number two is the writing. And I proved to you that the Sunnah was written at the time of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. So at the time of the Messenger, the Qur'an and the Sunnah are both present. Preservation-wise, they're both present. So no one can deny that.
So have you got any... Can I go and see a manuscript or something that was written by a companion in terms of the Sunnah?
There was suhuf written by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Asan. But that's what trickled into... You see what I mean? Like even the Qur'an right now, there's questions whether Uthman's Mus'haf, is it the one that's there or not? Do you see my point? But the Qur'an today, you find it's just here. This is the Mus'haf you're reading. You're not reading what Abu Bakr wrote with his hand. Or, the Mus'haf that the companions wrote.
Why do you rely so heavily on Bukhari then?
So again, there was something I was going to say before. So you said Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, wasn't the first person to write it.
Okay, you proved that.
Suyuti, rahimahullah, mentions in his Alfiyah, he says, أول جامع الحديث والأثر ابن شهاب آمرا له عمر. The first person to write was Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, who was a tabi'i. He was the first person to write it. وَأَوَّلُ جَامِعِ لِلْأَبْوَابِ جَمَاعَةٌ فِي الْعَصْرِ ذُقْتِرَابِ. Now, after that came a people we can't tell who was before who. I mean, they were all just right at the same time. Ibn Jurayjin wa Hushaymin wa Maliki wa Ma'marin wa Waladin Mubaraki. So we have Ibn Jurayj. We have Hushaym ibn Bashir. We have Malik ibn Anas. We have Ma'mar ibn Rashid. And we have Abdullah ibn Mubarak. These people all wrote it. These are the teachers of Bukhari. Or the teachers and teachers of Bukhari. Do you see my point? Bukhari came after that. The only difference between them and Bukhari is that Bukhari conditioned authenticity. They didn't condition authenticity. They compiled everything.
The other difference in the modern world, at least you can see, is everybody who follows the hadiths says Bukhari, Muslim, Bukhari, Muslim, Bukhari, Muslim. This is pretty much all you hear. And there's no doubt you yourself would admit that Bukhari's book of hadith is the most authentic. Is it not? Would you agree to that?
Yeah, أول مصنف في الصحيح محمد وخص بالترجيح.
Okay, great. So if you agree to that, then obviously it has a special importance in the science of hadith or this methodology of hadith. And it doesn't escape the fact that he came 250 years later. Talk me through the process between the time of the companions and him. How does that look? How can we be so sure that how can we trust that it hasn't been corrupted in those years?
You see, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, if his book gets lost right now, and we don't have Bukhari, all of those hadiths we have in other places.
Really?
Of course we do. What he did was, I told you this, people don't understand this. If you get rid of Sahih al-Bukhari right now, you destroy it and you... Those hadiths are in Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba and Musnad Imam Ahmad and Muwatta Malik.
Which are present today?
Of course. They're in other books of hadith. The only difference is Bukhari, he picked those hadiths based on authenticity. He conditioned something that no one preceded him in. He said, I'm going to condition authenticity. And the reason why he did that is because the ones before him, they needed to take every and anything that was attributed to the Prophet. So the first stage was, just take the hadiths. Just take it, whether it's sahih or not, don't worry. Just take the chain and write it down. The second stage was, this is wrong, get rid of this one, get rid of this one, get rid of this one. This is sahih, this is not. It was stages. It went through phases. It went through Bukhari's phase, or the stage that he was going through, was a hadith that are sahih.
Okay, question here.
And that's why people can quote Bukhari because he's sahih. تلقته الأمة بالقبول. The ummah unanimously agreed upon this book. Ijma', consensus, that is the most authentic book after the book of Allah, the Quran.
Okay, pause for a second here. How far do we take this? Do we believe that every single letter was preserved from the hadiths the way that we believe about the Qur'an?
No, you're right. The Qur'an, as I said to you before, the wordings, we are muta'abbadun bitilawati. We are worshipping Allah on this ayah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. You're worshipping Allah on every word, every letter. You're worshipping Allah with it. Lakin, as for the sunnah, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his speech, his actions, his consent, and his situation, his appearance, how he looked, how his manners were. His manners, there's no words to observe. Okay, I'm talking about the Prophet's manners. I'm going to use my own wordings.
Yeah, okay.
But that's a sunnah for us. The sunnah is also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he looked. Everybody would use their wording that they thought most appropriate for the appearance of the Messenger. Okay, the Prophet's actions. Everybody would use their own ta'bir, their own wordings to show how the Prophet ﷺ did an action.
Do you not see how this is problematic though when you're saying this? Because we actually worship Allah based on these actions, and you're saying that it might not be preserved completely word for word. Someone was just saying how he sees it, his opinion, his view.
You can't say that's not the case. Right now, if two people saw an incident, you'll ask them both what happened. You take a note down and you'd say, this is what the eyewitnesses said.
I agree that's the case. That's exactly how
it is. But are you worshipping Allah based... are you taking their words word for word verbatim, or are you using the meaning and the concept that's in them?
Even if you're using the meaning, because when you convey something word for word, it's obviously much stronger than when you're just conveying a meaning.
How can you... That's my question. How can you convey word for word an action that the messenger is doing? There's no word for you to
it. Exactly, that's my point. That's the danger of worshipping Allah based on these actions. Whereas if you follow the Quran alone, you wouldn't have to worry about
it. How is it dangerous? That's a leap.
Because the leap that I'm taking is that if somebody's conveying something that they saw, and I'm a normal human being, I'm not a prophet, I'm just a normal human being, and I'm conveying something that I saw, naturally, when I convey that, it's got my own filter in it. You have to admit that's the case.
Okay, so you saw it, another person saw it, another person saw it. Your story all seems the same. Maybe different. It's like somebody saying so-and-so is good. Another person said, yeah, he's righteous. Another person said he's noble. All of them, I want to understand it, that they're discarding him and belittling him. And that's what I want us to understand. We said that the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ are divided into the Prophet's wordings. What the messenger said, alayhi salatu wasalam. What the messenger said, again, there are wordings that are verbatim, took from him word for word, like the adhkar. The adhkar and the ad'iyah are word for word. Because we're worshipping Allah based on this now. Okay? There are wordings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that are narrated by meaning. And when it comes to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, this is the unique thing for the Qur'an and the unique and a unique thing for the Sunnah. The Qur'an, we worship Allah based on the wording and the meaning. The Sunnah, we're acting upon it based on meaning. That's what matters. It's meaning that matters, not the wording. As long as the meaning that both parties are conveying or all groups are conveying, we'll take it. See, this is a reliable person. A reliable person is telling you something. You have no reason to question his integrity. You have no reason to question his morality. He's conveying a message to you. You have to accept it.
Okay, let's go back to Bukhari. Do you believe that all of the hadiths in Bukhari, in a general sense, are authentic?
General sense, without a doubt.
Okay, random question. How many years did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remain in Mecca for before he migrated to Medina?
He stayed sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca for 13 years and in Medina for 10.
He didn't stay in Mecca for 10 years?
The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No, he didn't. He stayed there for 13 years.
So hadith found in Bukhari, narrated by Anas ibn Malik, Allah sent him as a messenger when he was 40 years old. Afterwards, he resided in Mecca for 10 years. One hadith. Another hadith, which is where you obviously get your answer from, narrated Ibn Abbas, Allah's Prophet was divinely inspired at the age of 40. Then he stayed in Mecca for 13 years. We have a book where you believe that in a general sense, all of these narrations are authentic. One of them says 13 years. Another one says 10. It's impossible for them both to be right.
Okay. But the chain to the Sahabi who said this statement is authentically transmitted from him.
If it's in Bukhari?
Sorry, Sahih. The companion did say this.
Okay.
Sah?
So now the companion got it wrong, you're saying?
We don't believe the companions are infallible or fallible. They can do mistakes, they can get it right, they can get it wrong. That you need to know.
Okay.
We don't believe that the Sahabas are free from errors and mistakes. Okay? We don't. They're humans. They can do it wrong. They can get it wrong.
Okay.
But I don't even believe the companion did it wrong here.
Okay, but before you move on to that. Okay, fine. Go on and tell
me. I don't even think he did a mistake, Aslan. But I'm just trying to put
that. How do you reconcile the two?
It's easy because the Arabs, they rounded numbers off. That was a common thing. I mean, we know we call the hadith of Imam al-Nawawi, we call it 40 hadith of Nawawi.
We do.
But it's 42 hadiths. What do you do with the other two hadiths? You say 40 hadiths. So the Arabs, they round off numbers. They round it off. So the companion rounded it off. And it's an Arab way of doing things. So the question here that I think you are trying to prove here is that Bukhari has weaker hadiths in there. But that hadith is authentically transmitted to the companion. That's Bukhari's job. And it's him who brought you the two narrations. Don't think he doesn't know numbers. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. He's just trying to show you that there's this view and there's that view. Okay?
Okay.
And both views can be reconciled.
Okay. Let's move on to a well-known statement that many people say. And that is a claim that one of the companions that narrated the most hadiths is Abu Hurairah. Is that correct, first of all? However, he only spent a very short time, maybe 4 years, with the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can he have narrated so many hadiths, having spent such a short amount of time with him, when other companions spent longer with the Messenger, and didn't narrate as many hadiths?
So here we have to distinguish one from the other. I'm not saying that Abu Hurairah heard more hadith than any other companion. We don't believe that. Or I don't believe that.
What do you believe?
There are other companions who heard more hadith from Abu Hurairah.
And but he's one of the highest, right?
Of the highest.
Okay.
I want two things to be distinguished.
Okay.
Him hearing more hadith from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or him narrating more hadiths. I'll give an example.
Mm.
I sat with you for one day.
Yeah.
And another brother sat with you for 10 years. That brother who sat with me, who sat with you for one day, I talk about everything I saw that one day. Mm. And the brother who sat with you for 10 years, he chose not to talk about it.
Right. So he knew more, but he chose not to.
So other companions, I wouldn't say they chose not to, but other aspects took over their lives. Like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who was busy with the wilayah and leadership and controlling the Muslim, this and that. So everything Abu Hurairah was saying, they already know it. If he was lying, they would say, this man's a liar, he's a kadhab. We were with the Messenger, he didn't say this. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number two, Abdullah ibn Amr al-As, Abu Hurairah said it, he himself said it with his own mouth. He said that Abdullah ibn Amr al-As, he heard more hadith from the Prophet than me. But the difference was, Abdullah ibn Amr al-As, ibadah overcame him. He got busy with ibadah and worship of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Whereas Abu Hurairah sat down in the masjid and he would just read narrations. Another thing is, Abu Hurairah heard other ahadith from the companions themselves.
What do you mean by that? Sorry.
So he narrated from a companion who narrated from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it wasn't all that which he heard from the Prophet directly. There are hadith that he wasn't alive to see, but he heard it from other companions like Abu Bakr and Umar and other companions he narrated it from.
Okay. I want to understand exactly what you believe the hadiths are, because we obviously believe that we take our religion from Allah. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a human being. Where did he get his hadith from? Where did he get these things from?
The ayah Allah says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never spoke from his own whims and desires. It's a revelation from Allah azza wa jalla.
The hadith were revelation
from Allah azza wa jalla.
So we're expected to sit and believe that everything that the Messenger did from the moment he woke up to the moment he went to sleep was a bit revelation, whether what the food he ate, well, anything, any kind of anything that he did.
Yeah, you just took my word out of context.
So what do you mean?
I said everything the Prophet
said,
and you said everything the Prophet does.
Okay, no problem. So this is restricted, but we also believe the hadiths are his actions, do we not? So are you saying that his actions are not revelation?
Not all of them. No, the ayah didn't say that to you.
How do you separate what's revelation, what's not?
But the ayah didn't say that to you. Everything he does, it says everything he said.
Okay, we'll come back to his speech, but for his actions, how do you separate what is revelation, what is not?
So anything that Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did to get closer to Allah, he did to get closer to Allah azza wa jalla. And there is no evidence which comes from him or from another external source that proves that this is specific for him. As long as it's not specific to him and he did it to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jalla, this is a ibadah that he got it from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Like in his speech, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's from Allah Azza wa Jalla.
So his speech is revelation from Allah. Let's go to the speech now. There were never times where he gave a verdict and then he was wrong and he had to come back and he had to give a new verdict. That never happened?
Any statement that there are times that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam,
he, so the first time he spoke, was that revelation?
No, he gave ijtihad. It was his personal independent answer.
Interesting.
So he gave a fatwa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He done ijtihad from himself, and then he got corrected for his ijtihad. So in essence, when the ayah says wa ma yantiqu anil hawa, he doesn't speak without revelation, it means the ultimate conclusion that the ummah will receive is a revelation from Allah azza wa jalla, from him. So whether he said it first or not, what reaches us and what we implement is going to be what? It's going to be the corrected version.
Okay, fine. We also know that when the Messenger used to receive revelation, there used to be physical duress that was seen upon him. Is that the case? So throughout his whole life, anytime he spoke, he's physically in duress?
Not every form of revelation. That wasn't all of his revelation.
What do you mean then?
Some of these revelations were hardship and it was... And some of them, there weren't. Like, he wouldn't always have a excessive pain in all the Qur'an that came down. Like, don't think to yourself that the revelation of the Qur'an was all in one particular form. No, it wasn't. Sometimes it would be in different ways. Like, for example, Jibreel came to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he revised the Qur'an with him. The last year he came, and this is a revelation. He was teaching him the Qur'an. So there were times that the Qur'an came to him other than a bell and a noise that wouldn't make him sweat like that.
So according to you, and in a verse that you mentioned earlier, one of the messengers, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's job was to explain the Qur'an. Why do we need that when Allah says, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ? Why can't we just use our own intellect to interpret the Qur'an the way we want, just like Allah is saying in this verse?
As in, why don't you ponder over it?
Yeah, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ? Why do we need someone else's pondering? Why can't we just take the Qur'an and understand it the way we want to understand it
and read it and get whatever? Like, what do you mean?
So you're restricting the understanding of the Quran to the Messenger's understanding, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Allah is saying, afala ta'qilun, do you not ponder, do you not use your intellect? So it seems to me that Allah is saying, look at the Quran and use your intellect to interpret it. And you're saying,
no, that's not what the ayah says.
Okay, what does it mean then?
The ayah didn't say read the Quran and look what it interprets, it says ponder over it. And it doesn't dismiss that you ponder on the Qur'an in line with what the Messenger came with, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that which his companions, the way they understood it. That doesn't deny the pondering when Allah said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا أَمْ أَفَلَمْ يَتَدَبَّرُوا الْقَوْلَ أَمْ أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليتدبروا آياتي.
So what do these verses mean in English?
Ponder over the Quran, contemplate over the Quran. It doesn't dismiss that you ponder over the Qur'an and you contemplate over the Qur'an based on the way that the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explained it. So when I ponder over the Qur'an, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayer, and I look at the word الصَّلَاةِ, what it means, and how the salah brings me in the salah tanha ani al fahsha'i wal munkar, that the salah prohibits a person from evil. And I think, say, subhanallah, look how many evils that I would have done if I didn't have to go to the jama'ah and pray in the congregation. And I ponder it over it like that, but not that wa aqimu salah. Yeah, man, this ayah is powerful. Subhanallah, the Quran, I don't have to pray salah.
Okay,
that's not what the ayah is saying. The ayah is saying contemplate on the Quran, عَلَى وِفْقِ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ, in a way that the messenger came with it and the way he explained it, صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَمَ. So I don't see a contradiction in the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم commenting on the Qur'an and explaining the Qur'an and pondering over the Qur'an.
Okay, you brought a lot of evidences and you brought some quite convincing arguments about why we should follow the hadiths, but there are a couple of questions that still remain with me. We have certain hadiths that seem very, very strange, very odd. For example, there was a hadith in Bukhari that talks about shaitan, the Satan, urinating in a man's ear. Surely we can, even if we don't reject hadiths in their totality, we can overlook these hadiths.
The Qur'an is the one that instructed us to believe in the unseen. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهُ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. We believe in the unseen. So it's the Qur'an that told us to believe in the unseen. So that is something we should believe in. It's from the unseen. And the sign of the muttaqeen, the pious people, is that they believe in the unseen. And subhanAllah, the reality of many people who I've seen who complain about sleeping paralysis and they say, oh look, I'm having problems in my sleep. When they do the adhkar that the hadith instructed, they say, subhanAllah, I'm fresh, I wake up, I don't have that problem. I don't have that problem. So there is a reality to what the hadith is mentioning, without a doubt.
Okay, my second question relating to not necessarily rejecting all of the hadiths, but rejecting some of them, is that, as you mentioned before, there are certain hadiths that have reached us through multiple chains. I think they're pretty reliable. If someone was going to say, I have to follow the hadiths, I'd be more happy to follow them than the one that has just come through one chain. Is it okay to just take the ones that have come through multiple chains and ignore the ones that are singular chain narrations?
This concept of the hadith becoming multitude and singular is a newly introduced matter. That wasn't the time of the messenger and his companions. They never knew this concept of, oh, how many people said it? Okay, we'll accept it. Oh, one person said it? No, I'm not going to accept it. And to be very honest with you, the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, only sent one person to nations.
How? When?
Like Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he sent him to the whole people of Yemen. And he told the people of Yemen to take, or he told Mu'adh ibn Jabal to talk to them about Tawheed and Aqeedah, one man, by himself. So it was one or two people that would go, or one person would go.
And they would go to teach the people about the sub-branches of the religion, or the creed or the belief of the religion?
Fundamental issues like Mu'adh, إِنَّكَ سَتَتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلِ كِتَابٍ فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُمْ شَهَادَةُ وَأَلَّا إِلَّا إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَإِنْهُمَا طَاعُكَ لِذَلِكَ فَأَخْبِرُمْ عَنَّ اللَّهِ فَتَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ. So La ilaha illallah was the first thing he was told to convey.
Okay, if you're claiming that the companions all understood that the hadiths are part of the religion and we should follow them, where did this concept of not following the hadiths originate from?
The history behind the rejection of the hadith, it's an early thing that was done. The first group that did it were the Khawarij, who rejected the hadiths. They rejected it and they just took the Quran. ولذلك, you know the woman that came to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. That woman, when she came to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said to Aisha, why is it that when we fast, we have to bring back the fasting? But when we pray, we don't have to bring back the praying. Like the prayer that we missed. Aisha, first thing she said to her is, she said, أَحَرُورِيَّةٌ أَنْتِ, are you Haruri? Are you Khariji? Are you from the group, the Khawarij group? Modern day ISIS, are you from them? So she said, no. The reason why Aisha asked is because the people, the Khawarij, would reject Sunnah. They would reject the Sunnah. They would only take the Quran. Supposedly, they'll say they would only take the Quran. So they were the early people, and also the Rafidah. The Rafidah rejected the Sunnah in totality. And great scholars came and they refuted them. From them is Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, who wrote a book on them called Minhaj Sunnah Nabawiyyah. جلال الدين السيوطي has written a kitab called مفتاح الجنة في احتجاج بالسنة. السيوطي رحمه الله تعالى. ابن الوزير اليماني has a kitab called الروض الباسم في الذب عن سنة أبي القاسم, where he refutes those groups. So those are the early people. But the rejection of the Khawarij and the Rafida was an ultimate, complete, unrestricted rejection. It's الرد المطلق of the Sunnah. رد السنة مطلقا, without any reason, like totally, the Sunnah, we don't need it, just the Qur'an. Then came after them deviated groups, like the Mu'tazila, like the Asha'ira, who are known as Ahlul Kalam, who got affected by philosophy and that, the Greek logians and their arguments. They now rejected the Sunnah partially rejection. Rad muqayyad. They rejected it when it's khabar al-ahad. We won't take it in usul al-deen or in aqeedah, but we will take khabar al-ahad in furu' al-shari'ah, you know, in sub branches of the religion. That's a form of rejection. That's a step closer to the complete and ultimate rejection. And great scholars refuted them, like al-Imam al-Shafi'i in his kitab al-Risala. He took time out for them, and he proved that the khabar al-ahad is taken. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, and many other great scholars. Then came a group in the 20th and the 21st century whose rejection of the Sunnah became apparent. From the earliest people in this era and this time was a man by the name of Ahmed al-Qadiani. And he's not the Qadiani that the group that they follow. It's another man who came out from Shiba Tuqar til Hindiya, came from the subcontinent, and rejected the Sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And then after him came Sayyid Ahmed Khan and Abdullah Jakar and Ahmaduddin, and now became a group. After Ahmed al-Qadiani, it became a group. But they weren't organized. After that became an organization made by Ghulam Ahmed. He made a muassasa, an organization, where he called it Ahlul Qur'an. And he used to bring, every month, he would bring out magazines in rejecting the Sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Now that's the subcontinent. They were the early people to do that. Then came out after that the Arab world. It came into Ardul Kinana, Misr, Egypt. And the way that it came to Egypt from was Muhammad Abduh, who took it from Al-Afghani, Jamaluddin Al-Afghani. He took it from him and it came. Muhammad Rashid Rida, he had a magazine that was called Majallatul Manar, Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida. One of the articles that came out on that magazine was called Al-Islamu Huwa Al-Quran. Islam is the Quran only. And it was written by a doctor, his name is called Tawfiq Siddiqui. And it's sad because Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida, he praised it and he endorsed it. SubhanAllah. And you know Muhammad Rashid Rida, you know, right? Mm. Who he is. He's the man who Sheikh Albani said, I got affected by him in Hadith. But he repented from this. Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida, at the end, he left that. He walked away from that. There's a Sheikh called Sheikh Al-A'zami. He has a kitab called Dirasat fi al-Hadith al-Nabawi. He refuted those arguments of Tawfiq Siddiqui. Mm-hmm. Then the second person who came out in the Arab world to push this, it was Abu Rayya. He wrote a kitab called Adwa' ala Sunnah al-Muhammadiyya, Abu Rayya. And Abu Rayya got refuted by the great Imam Dhahabi al-Asr of this time, the Imam Dhahabi of this era, Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi. Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi wrote a kitab called Al-Anwar al-Kashifa, where he refuted Abu Rayya's arguments and what he brought forward. And ever since they came out and they would come out, Allah will always make a people come out and to refute them. But this has no basis in the religion. Rather, the people who reject the Sunnah and they say we're only going to take the Quran are kuffar, they're not Muslims.
I was going to ask, what is the ruling on these people?
They're disbelievers. Based on the ayah, Allah says, وَكَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ وَأَنْتُمْ تُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتُ اللَّهِ وَفِيكُمْ رَسُولُهُ. Allah says, وَكَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ. How do you disbelieve? وَأَنْتُمْ تُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتُ اللَّهِ. The verses of Allah are being read on you. وَفِيكُمْ, and amongst you is the messenger. The messenger is amongst you. For the early generation, it physically meant he was with them. Yeah. But for us, it means the sunnah. What did the ayah say at the beginning? Why do you turn away from the Quran and turn away from the sunnah? and choose disbelief over it. That's what the verse is saying. So anyone who turns away from the Qur'an and the Sunnah, he is a disbeliever, he's not a believer.
Sorry, just to clarify, is that even for the people who don't reject the hadiths totally, but they reject certain narrations?
No, we're talking about the ones who reject it in totality. Great scholars have transmitted ijma', Ibn al-Qayyim transmitted ijma', Ibn Hazm transmitted ijma', Ibn al-Wazir al-Yamani's Kitab al-Dhab, Rawd al-Basim, he mentions ijma', Suyuti mentions in his kitab, he's Miftahu al-Jannah, he mentions the ijma', Ibn Taymiyyah brings the ijma', that they're all, there's no difference of opinion that these people are disbelievers, that they're not Muslims.
Okay, if we have people like this that we know in our friends or families, can we apply this ruling onto them?
No, you don't individually apply it on people. You guide them, you advise them, and you speak to them. Generally, when it comes to kufr, you don't take matters into your own hand and place it on people.
Okay.
But anyone who rejects the sunnah of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in totality, is not a Muslim in general now.
Okay, we have 2 minutes left on the show. What is your final piece of advice for anybody who rejects the sunnah?
I want to say to you, you're opening the door for groups like ISIS to exist. Whether you know it or not, it's your narrative that will make them spread.
How?
It's because the sunnah is there to prevent anyone coming and making their own interpretation for the Qur'an. I'll give you an example. The Khawarij, when they wanted to fight against Ali ibn Abi Talib, and they saw Ali to be a kafir, and they saw Muawiyah to be a kafir, and Amr ibn As to be a kafir, and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to be a kafir, and the noble companions to be kuffar, what was it that they were using? It's ayat. But those ayat were not taken back to the sunnah. So that's the narrative, and that's the type of people you're encouraging. Groups like that who just take a verse and just read it without taking it back to what the sunnah said, without taking it back to what the companions said. I'll give you the Khawarij who killed Abdullah ibn Khabab. They killed him and they killed his pregnant wife, and they brought the child out of her stomach, threw the baby on the floor. And then what did they say? They bring a hadith? No. They brought the ayah, وَلَا يَلِدُ إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَّارًا رَبِّ لَا تَذَلْ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ دَيَّارًا إِنَّكَ إِنْ تَذَرْهُمْ يُضِلُّ عِبَادَكَ وَلَا يَلِدُ إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَّارًا. They use that verse.
Sorry, English translation.
It's talking about the story of Nabilah Nuh. When Nabilah Nuh, he said to Allah, oh Allah, destroy these people. Oh Allah, destroy these people and don't let any one of them remain. Because what's going to come from these people, the offspring that they're going to have are disbelievers. So he's saying that Abdullah ibn Khabab's wife is pregnant. The child that she's going to give birth to is only a kafir. So let's kill her and nothing else is going to come from her except, you know, evil.
So they've taken a verse from the Qur'an and used their own intellect or their own reason or their own desires to interpret the way they want.
So the Qur'an, what narrows it down is the sunnah. What even narrows that more down is the companions.
SubhanAllah.
And then you and I don't need to say, what does this verse mean? How do we do it? No, we don't need that. We already say, what did Allah say? Okay, how did the Prophet explain it? Okay, and how did the companions understand that as well? And then that's how we live our lives. Then we wouldn't have people throwing verses around like that and playing around with the text as they wish.
Ustaz Abdul Rahman, it's been a pleasure as always. That's all we have time for on this episode. Jazakallah khairan once again for joining me. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. As you guys have seen, we've just had a discussion on whether the Sunnah and the Hadith are actually part of our religion. At the Hot Seat, we've actually written a book on this topic available for you guys to download for free from our website. Head over to www.thehotseatpodcast.com/resources where you can download the book for free. Please take a read of this and share it with anybody else that you might feel may benefit from this. It's written in very simple English, deconstructing this methodology step by step in a very easy to read book. Have a look at it, check it out, and please do share it with others. We're also conscious that many people might not actually want to read a PDF on their phone or their tablet. So we're in the process of getting this book as a hard copy on Amazon. Have a look at the same link, www.thehotseatpodcast.com/resources, in 1 week's time, and inshallah, you can find a link for the Amazon book as well.
I hope you enjoyed and benefited from that discussion. Please do share it with your friends and family members if you feel like they might benefit too. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button below so you're notified of any new episodes. Check out www.thehotseatpodcast.com. That's thehotseatpodcast.com. On there, you'll find a little bit more information about the podcast, and you'll also have the chance to vote for which topic you'd like to see discussed on the show. You can also ask questions on the website to the speaker himself about these contemporary modern day issues. Until next time, fi amalillahi, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.